applying positive psychology techniques to news process and production in an effort to just make the news more productive and more engaging. At the same time, it also focuses on sticking to the core functions of journalism. The major and important goal of constructive journalism is to improve societal and individual well-being by applying positive psychology tactics to news work. So this is actually how it works. It's more like a third leg to that of journalism. You can see here, this is breaking news, investigative news. The first two part is constantly being projected in the media. So breaking news is all about what is happening now. It is mainly focusing on the speed at which the news is being broadcasted. And it answers to the question, what and when, and style will be dramatic. And they will just focusing on the dramatic aspect of the event. If you just watch any breaking news in that of the regional media, you can just see that they will be using that tune and some dramatic style of expressing that event, right? And the role which the reporters do here is they are like the police who is just getting to the spot suddenly or at a very first stage. Investigative journalism just build upon this breaking news. It just look clearly, it is about yesterday, what has happened yesterday. And the major aim is to blame someone, to just frame someone for the problem which has happened. It just answers to the question who and why. The style will be so critical. The journalists will be just digging deeper and they will just perform the role of a judge, which is they must put somebody on the dais of the guilty one. And the focus will be mostly on that of the victims or the groups. Groups is just the villains. Victims is someone who is just affected, and the groups are who just caused the problem. Whereas constructive journalism focuses on tomorrow. Okay, the problem has been the problem has happened. So what can be done? What solution is there in this world which can be applied to end this problem from preventing it from happening again? It answers the question, what now and how. The goal is to inspire people. And here the reporter just performs the role of facilitator. That is, they just act as a facilitator between the experts and that of the news consumers. And they will help the people to get ideas of how things can be fixed from that of the experts. So this is the branches of constructive journalism. It's more like an umbrella term. And as you can see here, constructive journalism actually has its roots from civic journalism. Civic journalism also focuses on creating a healthier public climate. The only difference is civic journalism does not use positive psychology techniques, whereas constructive journalism uses positive psychological techniques for news process and production. So I will just go through one by one. Here comes the solution journalism. As you can see, these small diagrams in over there, right? These are some of the positive psychology techniques which are being applied in each and every of the journalism. So solution journalism is about rigorous reporting on solution or where things are working. That is what solution journalism is all about. Danish Broadcasting Corporation and The Economist are very best examples of solution journalism. The next one is prospective journalism. Prospection. It is future. Simply prospective journalism focuses on future. Okay, now we have built a solution to the problem, but we as a human beings can't be stagnant, right? We have to just build upon it. We have to progress. So prospective journalism focuses on progress. This is the Guardian Keep It In Ground, which is a very good example for prospective journalism. They are making an entire new focus on the very pressing issues like the global warming and the climate change. And comes the peace journalism. Peace journalism just works like this. The reporters will just think how to report on a problem or conflict. In that way, people will get an opportunity to act in a non-violent way to that of a conflict. Okay. So in this, the reporter reports about the conflict, but additionally, they also speak about the roots of the conflict or who is working to prevent the violence or who is just benefiting from reconstruction. So the Common Ground News Service is a very good example for peace journalism. You can just check all these websites and you will just really get an entirely new perspective about of viewing the world. And this is a restorative narrative. While the peace journalism focuses on international and national conflicts, restorative narrative focuses on community level conflicts. it just involves the stories of recovery and restoration, resilience on a community ground, which it covers either during the times of the events or after that of the conflict. So HIVO and the NPR Starting Over is a very good example for this. All of these comes under constructive journalism, and that lies this very small tree light. This is positive journalism. Positive journalism has the positive elements in constructing the news, but the very major difference between positive and constructive journalism is positive journalism does not hold any societal value. It's simply, for example, the news like a cat is being saved from the tree. It doesn't hold any societal value, right? It consists, positive journalism consists of stories like fluff or feel good kind of stories. It is what positive journalism covers. So these are just the branches of constructive journalism. And you may just ask how constructive journalism is going to bring any change, and how is this really impacting the mental health of the people around, or it is in helping the media to bring again or just jump back from the current scenario? The answer is yes, constructive journalism actually works. The initial researchers which have connected the MAP Capstone project and other researchers has found out that constructive journalism left people more engaged, and apart from reading the news, they also took it to the next level. That is, they acted upon the issue, and people just shared it more often than that of the negative news, and it made people informative, and people learn more from constructive news. And the most important message that the constructive news leaves is, world is not falling apart. This is an article by Steven Pinker, which was just published in Guardian magazine. You can just go through this article. That is this line, right? Whether or not the world is really getting worse, the nature of news will make us think that it is. We human beings, if you just can think about it, we have progressed at a very great and drastic rate in this past few decades. Yes, human beings make mistakes, they just stumble upon, but at the same time, they will just also learn from the mistake. They just grow. There will be progress. So clearly, we are not heading towards the doomsday. But the news today is making us believe that we are heading towards the doomsday. You can just see in all the media, all the newspapers, or in social media. But the real thing is, world is not actually falling apart. That is this part which is not being covered, which is not being shown to us. And constructive journalism plays a very important role in getting this part to us. So I hope you just have a very good idea about what constructive journalism is all about. I will be just explaining few elements of constructive journalism so you can just get a clear idea of how things are working in constructive journalism, how to construct news or that of some information that it will benefit the people. So these are few of the elements which is being used in constructive journalism. The number one is solution, and number two is future orientation, and beacon and rule, which is actually a psychological concept. It is being applied to that of constructing news in this particular type of journalism, and also focuses on stuff like post-traumatic growth and resilience. Focuses on stories like post-traumatic growth and resilience. So the number one, solution. Let me be so clear here that constructive journalism doesn't mean problems or killings or things that is not working should not be reported. These things must be covered. Journalists must act like a watchdog, or they must report about the abuse of power and also keep the power in account. But at the same time, they have to focus on in equal amount about the solutions too. Simply, in covering problems, also add a solution-oriented framing of news. This is one element of constructive journalism which is used in that of solution journalism. So the thing here is, by showing that something is working in one place, the excuses for failure elsewhere is weakened. That is, if a solution to a particular problem is worked in one part of the world, then the people who are in power or authority can't just simply deny that, right? It just worked there. They must implement it because there is a proof that this solution worked in some part of the world. This is one example of the solution being used in the news. So you all know currently we're just going through this pandemic, and there is no exact end to this or solution to this. There are various things which we have to do to prevent us and our families and our society from this virus. Few of this is vaccines, it includes vaccines and also physical distancing or herd immunity. So that is this particular state in the southern part of India, which actually did a very good job on controlling the spread of this virus. This model is here as a solution to the problem. So this model is widely adopted by other countries now. So if they just apply, the problem is solved there, right? This is the importance of providing solutions while covering a problem. And the next one is future orientation. So as I told you earlier, we have now found a solution, how we can just improve it or how we can just make a progress in it. We should not be stagnant, right? This is an example for the two newspapers and news media, which is doing a very great job in covering the future orientation. On the right side, the De Correspondent, which is a Dutch online media platform. You should just check it out. It's quite innovative. They have a correspondent for reporting about progress. And on the left side, Keep It In The Ground by the Top Stick Guardian. They just, as I told you, they just view the entire climate change and the global warming events in a very new frame. So the next one is Seek an Intro. This is a psychological concept. It simply means that people judge an experience largely based on how they felt at a peak, or at peak means at a more intense point, or at the end. They will not just judge the experience by the total sum, but they just judge a particular event by how they felt in the peak or that of in the end. I'll just give you an example. I hope you just get clear. So, you know, when you just ask a mother about how they felt when their child was born, they will entirely forget about this labor pain and things like that. But they will just describe how their child just came out and about their first cry, right? This is what picking is all about. They do not just judge the event by the whole experience, but by the peak, that's the part where the child is born, and by the end. So this is one of the techniques which can be used to frame the constructive news. Like that is this one project called as the MAP Capstone Project, in which they actually took up the original news with the exact same facts, but they constructed in three different ways. The first news had positive end and positive peak, and the second news had negative end and negative peak, which is a classic article as you're seeing right now. And the third one is a neutral article. So they just found the story with a positive end and a positive peak actually made the people to engage more, and it made them to act upon. Whereas the story which had a negative end and negative peak just made them feel hopeless, powerless, and also passive. This is one example for why I'm just insisting that words matter. So on the left side, you can just see the headlines of the newspaper, and on the right side, you can just see headlines, right? Definitely, these two news, when you read it, will have a very different impact on your mood and feeling, right? Which one you would prefer? Mostly, I think the one on the right side. Together, we can save many lives. This is why words is very important, while just letting know people about what incidents are happening out there. You have to just construct it in a way that just helps them to recover or grow, or which gives them hope. So this is a fourth element, resilience, using resilience and post-traumatic or recovering stories like this. Resilience is simply coping up with crisis or jumping back from some difficult situation, and whereas post-traumatic growth is growing back from that of a traumatic event. So you can just see, this is the data from Friday. Between the confirmed cases and the number of deaths, there lies something called as recovered. In India, the recovery rate is almost off that of the confirmed cases. But when you just wake up, you'll be hearing how many people are affected, how many deaths are there. Yes, we should cover how many lost their life. But also at the same time, people have recovered. Stories like these need to be shown to the people, projected to the people, so that when they also fall into some situation like that, it will just give them the strength to cope up with the situation and just come back from the situation. And on the right side, you can see image. This is an Hub Curtain, which was made by people in Canada and Brazil, actually their mothers and fathers or being in old age home, they are not able to meet them due to this pandemic. So they just created this hug curtain. You can just hug the person on the other side. It is something, some story which just still tells us or teaches us that our bad life we've seen, that is something we can always do and succeed at, right? So these are very few elements which I just described to help you understand what constructive journalism is all about. Other positive psychology techniques or elements which are used in constructive journalism include broaden and build up theory, and also the Penmo model is widely used to facilitate the talks in news debate. You can just check about this later. And also the core function purpose of constructive journalism is to act like a depolarizer instead of being a polarizer. Depolarizer is like bridging two communities instead of separating them or creating conflicts between them. So, sum up, this is again a question for you. In the past 3 days, how many news that you saw was constructive? Either the news may be solution focused or future oriented, or it is a stories of resilience. Just use the chat box or write it down. Okay, if the stories which you heard consisted of either constructive element, either constructive news or that of the negative news, if both of these are in balance, that is the constructive news and negative news are in balance, it is good. It means that we are just at least getting an accurate portrait of the world. If one just exceeds another, then the thing is, we are not exactly getting what's happening out right there in the world. So, okay. Catherine Kilstead is one of the pioneers in constructive journalism. So she just explains in one of her talks about the importance of adding investigative journalism to constructive journalism. This is how she just described it. Was pretty amazing. So when journalists look for hotspots, that is where there is things are not going right or where there is problem, journalists look for these spots and they just go there and throw stones over there and they will just wait, and whatever coming out of this, either a conflict or abuse of power, they will just write it down. And after that, they will just go to another hotspot, they will start throwing stones over there, and they will just write it down, those stories. But what they are leaving on their path is ruins. It's exact ruins, which is no use to anybody. So it's simply that tearing down is important. But at the same time, they have to focus on the story where things are being rebuilt. It is very crucial. Constructive journalism is all about showing where human are progressing or where there is human endeavors and where there is opportunities for growth. It is important to cover where things are falling down, but at the same time, it's very, very essential and crucial to show where education is rising or where poverty is diminishing, where democracy is growing. It is also essential. So this is one image or photo which just shows very neatly what is happening. So you can just see here what the media are currently focusing more on, and that lies a whole world out there which is being denied for some reason. So they are really not getting an accurate portrait of the world. Constructive journalism just focuses on this to provide people with the accurate portrayal of the world. So the next one is well-being model. Simply adding positive psychological elements into how journalism reports on the world adds to the well-being model of the world. So journalists must think before just broadcasting any news whether they are contributing to the well-being model of the world or that of the disease model of the world. So the future of this field is actually a growing domain. It expands along with whatever work positive psychology is doing. It grows along with positive psychology or moral psychology and prospective psychology. And for research enthusiasts out there, this is a particular domain where you can just do lots of research. Especially in our geographical area, more number of research is needed related to this field. And to the studying reporters or journalists, try to use constructive elements in the way you're reporting about the world. That don't just view it with the one eye, but view the world with both the eyes. It is very, very essential. So I think I just finished pretty quick. So once again, these are additional materials where you can just explore more about constructive journalism. I only just gave a very base outline of what constructive journalism is all about. The first book is by Catherine Blundstedt. She, along with her colleague, framed the concept of constructive journalism in 2015. This is a book from Mirrors to Movers. She just simply explains that people are not just journalists are not mirroring the world; they're actually moving it with their writing. She neatly explains about the elements of positive psychology which is being applied in constructive journalism. With many and various examples, you can just quickly understand about those. And this is a book by Judy Jackson, You Are What You Read. Judy Jackson is actually a news consumer turned campaigner for constructive journalism. There is this link, YouTube link, right? This is her video. She has just explained beautifully about the current scenario of the news industry and what she as a consumer is demanding from this industry. You can just try out this book. And this is the book Constructive News by Ulrich Agarup. This is also Ulrich Agarup is an former editor of Dutch Media Corporation and also the president of the Constructive Institute in Netherlands. So as I just finished earlier, we will just go with the question and answer session. It's the time for discussion. Hello, can you hear me now?
Yeah, yeah. Thank you so much. That was a wonderful presentation.
Okay. So I'll just stop recording. 1 second.
Yeah, sure.
Okay.
Yeah, so now we have the question and answer session. Participants, please feel free to ask your questions to our resource person. You can post your questions in the chat box and she'll address them.
No, I'm not able to see any chats. No, there is no chat. No questions are being posted. Either they might have understood everything or would have not understood anything. I will just take it in the first way. Can we just let them speak through video?
Sorry?
There is this one chat. So he's just telling that, yeah, it's true. Actually, this as a psychologist, we should not confine ourselves within a particular setting. We have to just go out there and collaborate with people from other field also. In here, constructive journalism just is a bridge between that of, or merge between that of positive psychology and that of journalism. We must just look out to those opportunities too. That is, interdisciplinary approach must be there. Is there any other questions here? If anybody have any questions, please raise your hands.
There is a question in the chat box.
Yeah, I saw the day. It's not a question. It's more like... Oh yeah, there is a question. How does positive psychological principle applies to journalism? I think that's what ma'am is asking. Yeah, ma'am. Positive psychology is more like a base for constructive journalism. There also, if you just refer to the book Mirrors to Movers by Catherine Gilster, you can just visibly see how she's applying each and every concepts or topics in positive psychology to that of the journalism. The PERMA model is used for that of facilitating the news debate, and she just gives a clear view on how each and every question can be framed, each and every question in an interview or that of in a debate can be framed with the help of PERMA model. In that way, it just provides some valuable outcomes from either the people in authority or that of the peer experts who are just participating in the debate. Next question, is there any question?
Yeah, we have questions in the chat box. You want me to read them out?
Example question based on that. Okay, ma'am. So as I mentioned earlier, Catherine, she's one of the pioneers in that of this constructive journalism. It all started there. She just went to interview a person who just lost her life due to that of a recent hurricane, I think. So when she just went to interview her, Catherine just asked a lot of questions to that lady. She just viewed it with that lady with this angle, that as if she's a victim, she lost her life and there is nothing for her in the future. So the way she just asked the questions are also like this, because she already had in her mind that she lost everything. So that's how she just asked questions to that lady. But when she is at most on stage of finishing the interview, that lady suddenly stopped and just told that, "I also learned something from this event." So what she learned is that how people around her helped her to overcome this problem, and she still have a house to live. This is what she's learned. Simply what I'm just trying to convey, viewing the people as victim or it's equivalent to that of viewing them as helpless. It just promotes it of the learned helplessness, whereas we just need to view the people in that context of how they just coped up with it, resilience or post-traumatic growth. There's another question. Can you please update us the positive points of COVID-19? Okay, this one's pretty good question. As I just told you earlier, I don't have that much clear things about that, but I just think this COVID-19 just gave us some more time to spend with family. You can just see in this column of the Hindu, keep that habit. They just have a specific column in that they will be just writing how there will be lots of stories. They will be just writing how this COVID-19 has really helped the people to engage more with their family. And there is this one particular lady who wrote, "My tea breaks are now with the toys of my fire hose." It just gave us a clear idea of how important family is all about, or how important people around us. This is one of the positive points of COVID-19. I think there are some questions posted in the YouTube. Can you just please tell me what are those questions, Ashita?
Sure. I'll just get back to you. Am I audible?
Yes, I am audible.
We have a question on YouTube. So, what is your view on news channels that often hit people's hope by flashing break news and big breaking news about corona that somehow puts the hope down from the recovery from this pandemic?
Okay, as I mentioned, there is nothing wrong about telling the loss of life or who is just being affected more. The point here is we also have to just focus more on that growth which people is having, or how people are just coping up. And at times, as I just viewed for this long, some breaking news or not even being informative, just for the sake of putting it, people are just putting it. So breaking news is essential for learning things. The way they just quoted it could have been much more different than it is being now. I hope I just answered the question.
Yeah, any other questions from our participants? We have a suggestion in the chat. The speaker could introduce the history of this concept or practice, say from interpretive journalism to civic journalism to constructive journalism, like more a participatory approach, so that it will make it easy for our listeners and the participants.
I don't have that much idea about interpretive journalism. Actually, constructive journalism, as I just researched, the word constructive in this news application started around 1940s, I think, and civic journalism came later in 1970s. So already most of the leaders are practicing constructive journalism without actually using that label or the name. For example, this solution journalism was practiced from 2000 by an organization called the Solution Journalism Organization. And this term, especially this term, was coined in 2015 when Catherine and there is another colleague of hers, they just did their PhD in positive psychology. That's how they just merged both the positive psychology and that of the constructive journalism of the University of Pennsylvania. From 2015, this concept became widespread, especially in the European countries and in some parts of the US currently. But it's not reached that much in the rest of the Asian countries. This is the history. Now it's just growing at a very drastic speed, and there is a very good future for this field.
Okay, the session is open for discussion. If any of you want to discuss with the speaker, you're free to unmute and add your points and discuss with our speaker.
Is there anyone?
Yes, there is a question, Madhuli. What do you think will be the consequence of civic journalism in the long run on a massive level? It's in chat box.
No, I just didn't get you.
What do you think will be the consequence of civic journalism in the long run on a massive level?
So civic journalism is actually more like integrating journalism in that of the processes of democracy. So it just is simply like most people, I just have to use this example, most people are not putting that much effort in the political debate, stuff like that, right? It is very much essential for people to participate in the political debate or what is happening in the politics. Civic journalism is all about that, to engage people more into the politics, especially the democratic process. I think in the long run, civic journalism can just make some better changes, especially in the democratic countries. That's what my view is all about.
Okay, thank you so much. So that was a really insightful session. Thank you so much for, you know, sharing with us so many points on constructive journalism. A webinar in this topic is very rare. So yeah, thank you so much.
Okay.
Yes, sir.
Just to add on to that civic journalism perspective.
Mm. Yes, sir.
See, civic journalism or simply it is citizen journalism or engaged journalism.
Mm. Yes.
It's more like we not just present a particular issue or a news, we also ensure that people deliberate and discuss more on that, and they come up with a lot of possibilities and options to solve a particular problem. But the only challenge would be this: you will have a lot of input, but you will not have a clear strategy.
Yeah.
Too many inputs and too many solutions you will have, but you will have to choose which one will be appropriate for which situation. What will work today may not work tomorrow. So one challenge would be this: when it comes to civic journalism, you will have a lot of ideas, a lot of inputs, because you are engaging so many people in the process. And they will also love contributing. But the only problem is which one to choose, how to choose, and how to implement. And at what level.
Okay.
So, that is when from civic journalism, people started moving into constructive journalism, where we also try making people see the solution. Because most of the time, we don't want a solution from others. We have a solution inside us. That's how we see behavioral science. Everyone has a solution for the problem that they are facing. The only thing is, we are more engaged and absorbed into the problem, so we are not able to see the solution.
Yeah.
That's why in counseling, you ask for, how do you think you will handle this particular issue of yours? They will start thinking and they will come up with a solution. So, which they all have. So, constructive journalism is more like that, where you will ask people, you will trigger people with the solution. Maybe I was typing it in the chat box. In the introduction, you could have given the history, because we had the problem of Great Depression. People were completely down because economically, emotionally, they were off completely. The same thing is happening now also during COVID-19. Economically, emotionally, we are facing a different kind of situation. So from then, my duty is not just to report a news saying so many died, so many is suffering, so many is contained, or so many is isolated. Instead of that, I should engage people in finding a solution. And that's why you can see a lot of executives, especially your, collectors and so many other executives in the state, they are engaging the public in so many ways in terms of how to handle it, how to handle the emotions. So constructive criticism is one thing that we use in presentation. Similarly, constructive journalism here is all about engaging people, because it is everyone's problem. The community grief is what we are going through now. It is not one person or one family's grief, but community grief. So that will work out. The only thing is, when someone suggests a solution, immediately what can prompt or what can come up is this: what do you, number one, and I am suffering, I am going through this trouble, You are saying, say, as a third person, it's easy for you to give a solution to this. Effective journalism is to be handled so safely.
Okay.
But what do you think, like constructive journalism, do you think there is a scope?
No, I don't get you, sir.
No, do you think there is a scope, enough scope for constructive journalism today?
Is there enough scope for constructive journalism?
Yes.
That's what your question is, right?
Yes, yes.
To be clear, in a country like ours, there are a lot of problems also that are happening in Janushan. In here, I don't think it holds that much scope. But I think change will gradually happen. So in future, there is some possibility for it.
No, no, constructive journalism, it's already old enough concept. It's nothing new. Okay? Nothing new.
Okay.
I'm asking about how it would be in the future or how it can be taken further forward. Because everyone now, with the help of technology, as you said, they know about all these concepts, practices.
Yes.
They know what Times London is doing using all these principles. So, can you be a little more specific about constructive journalism in India, the scope?
No, I just don't have much clear idea about it. If you just have any idea about it, you are free to share. Hello?
No, it will take the discussion forward, so maybe we can take it offline.
Okay.
If someone has a question, we can take it now.
Okay, sir. Hello,
Shita. Yeah, hi. So, thank you so much, sir. Those inputs were really valuable.
Thank you.
Yeah. You're welcome, sir. You have a question in the chat.
Yeah.
Though we talk about constructive journalism for creating hope in us, negativity in social media impacts us a lot. Can you please comment on that?
Okay, like social media is, from the beginning, I'm just focusing on traditional media because social media is entirely new. It just changes the way of how news is being transmitted these days. And yeah, each and every person is actually holding that job in their hands. Right now, they're just reporting like reporters in the social media. It is one collection of unstructured data, but that is just one particular research which was done previously. So they just found out that positive news, which creates hope, and also at the same time negative news, which instills anger or anxiety, is just being shared more than that of the news, which is so sad. I can just tell as of now that social media can be just, or now it can be used to find out what information or what kind of news people are sharing at a much rapid rate. We have to just come up with some specific kind of preventive measures for just to prevent social media. That's what I can just tell about it, because it's unstructured and a big bunch of data, so not that much easy to analyze. You can just use sentiment analysis or sentiment mining to just track what is going on in social media. It surely does negative impact on us. As of now, I can just suggest you that you can just take some break from social media. That is what I can just give you, because we can't just go out there and tell that much people about how to report carefully, right? That's it.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, thank you so much. So with that, we come to the end of the second session of the Student Self-Development Program webinar series. We would like to extend our heartfelt thanks to the entire management of PhD College of Arts and Science, our respected secretary, sir, our respected principal, ma'am, for this opportunity to host such an event. Our sincere thanks to our dear HOD, ma'am, Dr. T. Jyotimani, ma'am, for her encouragement in organizing such an event. We would also like to thank our resource person for the day, Ms. Madhuli PM. Thank you so much for this wonderful session. It gave us a lot of clarity about what constructive journalism is all about and about how big an impact it can have, you know, in creating a healthy society. Thank you so much. We would also like to extend our thanks to all our participants for your patience and, you know, for participating in this session very enthusiastically. We really appreciate it. We look forward to meeting you all in session 3 tomorrow, which will start at 11 a.m. sharp. So we look forward to seeing you there. The link for the feedback form for this session will be shared in the WhatsApp group, which you all are part of. So please take time to fill the feedback form as it is a prerequisite for receiving your e-certificate. Once again, thank you so much for your patience. Let you know.